Thank you all. If you would, turn to your Bibles in the book of 1 Samuel. I was given a time limit, and I aim to... it's what I've been doing for the past 3 days, using this stopwatch. Whenever I start reading, I hit start. I haven't started yet, preacher. Whenever I start reading, I hit start. And I've taken 2 pages of notes and condensed them to a half a page. And we'll just see. I do appreciate the opportunity that your pastor, our pastor, has afforded me this evening. You don't know what it means to me. All right, 1 Samuel chapter 30. It's a familiar book of the Bible. It's a familiar story in the Bible. But I hope we can take something and maybe use a little application and apply it to our lives and be a help to us this evening. And it says in verse 1, "And it came to pass when David and his men were come to Ziklag on the third day, that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag and smitten Ziklag and burned it with fire, and had taken the women captives that were therein. They slew not any, either great or small, but carried them away and went on their way. So David and his sons came to the city, and behold, it was burned with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters were taken captives. Then David and the people that were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep." Like I say, this is a familiar story, and we know what happens in the end. We know for the sake of time that David ends up recovering what he had lost, and David wound up getting back the wives and the captives and the sons and daughters and everything that he had stolen, even down to the camels and the sheep and everything. He got all that back. But there's a couple things that I would like to take from this scripture this evening and look at. How did David recover what he lost? Because I believe we can do that. We've all lost some things in our lives. And I believe that we can take some scripture and use this Bible and apply it to our lives so that we can then use the concepts and the precepts from it to help us. Yes. And so how can we recover what we've lost? First, I think in verse 6, you'll see, and it says, "And David was greatly distressed, for the people spake of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God." Yes. Yeah. I like that it says David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. You say, preacher, what's that mean? Well, it means that David just got to sitting amongst the ice and the burn, the ruin, and the desolation. And he got to looking around, and I don't know exactly what he did. He was a musician, so maybe he had a song on his heart that he started to sing, or maybe he had something that he started to play back in his own memory, in his own mind. But I do believe this, beyond a shadow of a doubt, to encourage yourself in the Lord, you have to think back about what God's done for you. Yes. You have to reconsider. You have to go back in your mind and make yourself sometimes. Sometimes it's difficult, but sometimes you got to make yourself go back in your mind's eye and remember what God's done for you. Remember how good God's been to you. You know, David could have been thinking about whenever Saul was trying to kill him, and he could have very easily been put to death right then, but the Lord spared him and the Lord saved him. He probably remembered that. He probably remembered whenever he was on the battlefield and he was facing that big giant. He was just a small boy, and he was a lot bigger and a lot stronger and a lot mightier than he, and he only had 5 stones and a sling. But somehow the Lord, absolutely the Lord, helped him, and he slayed that giant. Maybe he thought about whenever he was a little boy and he was watching over the flock and watching over the lambs, and the bear came and the lion came, and he slew them. Only with God's help. David was always quick and sure to give God the praise and God the honor for what he had done. But I believe as he sat there in those ashes, he just began to remember and recall about what God had done for him. It'd do us some good to remember what God's done for us in our lives. It'd do us some good as we have these prayer requests and supplications that we talked about this evening, to go ahead and make yourself go back and remember the last time God answered your prayer for you. Go back and remember the last time God done something for you. I have lots of memories, lots of illustrations I could use, but one that stands out the most was my son. You all may not know it, but the teenage boy and girl that sang a couple times here the last couple weeks, that's my son and daughter. And my son, whenever he was about 4 years old, was sliding down the banister at our home, and he fell about 10 or 12 feet and landed head first on a hardwood floor. I don't have time to go into all the details of it, but it was a thud like you wouldn't believe. And whenever I went and picked his little body up, it was lifeless like a sack of potatoes. It was absolute devastation to his mother and I. We rushed him to the emergency room, and they said he had a bleeder to the brain. I don't know what a bleeder to the brain is, but for a young daddy, it's something that scares you half to death. And I remember being in that emergency room, and I remember going to the bathroom by myself and crawling on the floor and begging God to do something, and begging God to heal my son, and begging God to show himself real in my life. And I can't tell you, I can't explain it, how it was in the midnight hour, 3 o'clock in the morning. We're in the intensive care unit, and he's got the neck brace on, he's got the hoses hooked up to him and the wires and everything. everything. And it's scaring me plumb to death. Somehow the peace of God come down and comfort me. And he wrapped his arms around me and he just loved on me for a little while.
Yes.
And I didn't know what the outcome was going to be, but I knew that everything was going to be all right. And sometimes I have to make myself think back to times like that just to remember myself, just to encourage myself in the
That's
Lord.
Right.
Secondly, not only did he encourage himself in the Lord, but he inquired at the Lord in verse number 8. And David inquired of the Lord, saying, "Shall I pursue after this troop? Shall I overtake them?" I found it very interesting that David asked God, "Should I go after them?" You're talking about they had their families, they had their children, they had their wives, and God says, "Should I go?" David says, "Should I go after them?" So often at times I think that we pray a prayer to God that we're not praying, "What would you have us to do?" or "What would you have in my life?" But we're praying a prayer, "This is the result that I need. This is the answer that I need, and I need you to answer in this way."
Yeah.
How about we start praying a prayer more like David, that we say, "Hey, God, if it's meant for me to go through this trial, if that's going to make me a better Christian, that's going to make me a better servant, that's going to make me a better layman, then by all means, let me go through this trial." Instead of just praying, "Lord, get me through this trial."
Yes.
Instead of anticipating what the outcome should be, I thought David had it backwards, because he encouraged himself in the Lord first, and then he inquired at the Lord. As I was putting this together, and I was going to rearrange it, I was going to change it, and the Lord knocked on my heart's door, and he said, "Don't you remember those times that you couldn't inquire at me because you needed to encourage yourself first?"
Yeah.
So I don't know if you've ever been this way. Maybe it's just me. Maybe I'm not as strong of a Christian as some of you all, but there have been times in my life, maybe even sometimes recently, that it's just been difficult for me to pray. Not because I'm in some gross sin, not because I'm doing something wrong, just because I don't even know what to say. I found myself in the past several months being at this altar right here and kneeling down and not knowing what to say and just saying, "God, help. God, help. God, help." Over and over again, I didn't know what to say. It wasn't because I didn't want to say something else. It's because I didn't know what else to say. And men of God gathered around me and prayed with me, and I just kept saying, "God, help! God, help!" I sure am thankful for a God in heaven that understands our groanings, that understands our moanings, that understands our tears, that understands our heart, that understands what we need better than what we understand our own selves. I sure am thankful for that God. And so you have to encourage yourself from the Lord. You have to inquire at the Lord. And that brings us to the end where he was enabled by the Lord.
Amen.
He was enabled. So fast forward, you know that he and his 400 men went and marched after. And they absolutely tore them to shreds and got everything back. The Bible was very clear to illustrate that they got everything back that they had lost. They did not lose not one thing in that. And the only way they could do that is if God enabled them to do so. You say, "Brother Dave, what are you talking about this? I haven't had anything stolen. I've never had circumstances like David went through. I've never went home and my entire town be burned and lost my family and lost everything that I had." We don't have the same adversary that David had, but we sure enough do have an adversary.
Amen.
And he walks around seeking whom he may devour. And I'm telling you, he's here to kill, steal, and destroy.
Yes.
And he absolutely wants to steal things from you. He absolutely wants to take things from your life. He absolutely wants to change who you are. He can't change our outcome. We're saved and bought by the precious blood of Jesus. He can't say and change that, but he sure enough can't have effect on your life here.
Yeah.
He sure enough can. He wants to steal things.
Right.
He wants to steal your happiness. He wants to steal your joy. He wants to steal your peace. He wants to steal your family. He wants to steal your home. He wants to steal your marriage. He wants to steal your children. He wants to steal your church. He wants to steal your pastor. He wants to steal everything that he can from you. Me by myself, I can't take him on. I'm not saying anything. I'm not trying to raise him up as to what he is. But me by myself, I'm just weak. And I can't handle fighting him. And I can't go up against him. And I can't enable myself on my own. But with God's help.
Yeah.
Greater is he that's in me than he that's
Amen.
In the world. I said, greater is he that's in me
yes,
than he that is in the world. So with God's help, I'm enabled that I can go back and I can march into the enemy's camp and I can take back what he stole from me. I can take back my happiness and I can take back my joy and I can take back my testimony. I can take back my family. He can't have them. He can't have my family. He can't have my children. Here recently, I guess over the past couple of months, I've been told, I don't know if it's the devil or if it's my own thoughts in my own head. I don't know, but I've laid there at night. I've had this thought. I'll never be behind the pulpit again. I don't know if he's outside. I don't know if the devil's lurking around outside the doors, but just in case he is. Hey, enlighten me now, devil. Hey, it's nothing to do with me. It's nothing to do with what I have or what I'm doing, but it's God in his great mercy. It's God in his wonderful kindness, and I thank you for it tonight. Encourage yourself in the Lord. Inquire at the Lord, and then be enabled by the Lord.
Good preaching.